All right, it is very, my great pleasure to introduce Juan to you. Juan Zarate was Deputy Assistant to the President and Deputy National Security Advisor for Combating Terrorism under the previous administration. He currently serves as a Senior Advisor for the Center for Strategic and International Studies, which is probably the world's most important think tank in Washington. And he's a National Security Analyst for CBS News. And is with the Vatican Institute for the Works of Religion. Early on in his career, Juan served as a prosecutor in the Department of Justice's Terrorism and Violent Crime Section after graduating from Harvard University and going on to Harvard Law School. He came to the White House from Treasury, where he served as Assistant Secretary for Terrorist Financing and Financial Crimes. He led Treasury's domestic and international push to develop financial warfare as a third way between bombs and bullets, to deal with national security threats by disrupting terrorist financing, building anti-money laundering systems, and instituting sanctions against the nuclear programs of North Korea and Iran, which has arguably led them to seek resolution through negotiation. He's led global efforts to seize Saddam Hussein's assets and to recover those of Muammar Gaddafi. He's written two very good books, Forging Democracy, on the impact of U.S. foreign policy on democracy in Central America, and more recently, Treasury War, the unleashing of a new era of financial warfare about the revolutionary use and effectiveness of financial power to counter terrorism, runaway nuclear ambitions, and other bad things. And I suggest you all read it. It's a fantastic book, and it's, in fact, a founding book of a new form of warfare in the 21st century in defense of national and international security. I also want to say that although we often are on different sides of the political divide, he is one of the very, very few people I would ever trust to help lead the nation through difficult times. He's also a very warm and sincere person. I love the guy. Juan Zarate.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. As you can tell, I have deep affection for Scott, Professor A. Trent. Excuse me, Professor. Really want to thank you for that kind introduction. I count Scott as a close friend, a close colleague, and though we do sometimes have differing opinions on issues, I count his counsel as one of the most important that I keep, and his friendship is one of the most important that I have. So you're very lucky to have Scott here as a professor, and I hope you indulge in either your courses or in interactions with him. Charles, I want to thank you for inviting me here to John Jay. This is now the second time I've spoken at John Jay. It's really an honor. It's great to see the expansion. This theater is new.
You were in North Hall.
I was in it was a smaller hall. It was a great gathering, though, I will tell you. It was a fun event, and I appreciated the invitation then, too. But this is a really great tribute to the college and to the expansion and to its importance, not just in the city, but internationally, because I know the role that John Jay plays in educating people from around the world. So really a pleasure. And Peter, I want to thank you as well for hosting. And we had a great lunch, you and Scott and others and colleagues. And so thank you to the John Jay community for having me. What I thought I'd do today is talk a little bit about the topic of my book. I'm happy to venture into other issues because I've been incredibly fortunate to have worked professionally in a number of fields in national security. The last government role I had was in the context of coordinating our counterterrorism policies. But what the book is really about is this new era of financial warfare and the intersection of financial and economic power and national security and where that's taking us. And that's why I wrote the book, and it's the topic of today's discussion. So I'm looking forward to talking to you about it and certainly taking your questions at the end. One need only look at the headlines to understand the importance of these issues. When I wrote the book, these issues were obviously in the news, but perhaps not as prevalent as today. If you look at the debate over how to deal with Russia and Russian adventurism in the Ukraine, the question often devolves to how we can use economic and financial power and isolation to impose costs on Moscow and to change Putin's calculus. If you look at the question of the Iran nuclear debate, and the negotiations happening as we speak. The question is whether or not the economic sanctions that have brought them to the table can ultimately drive a deal that will avoid war, and whether or not the unwinding of sanctions can be a part of a real and sustainable deal. If you look at the question of how to deal with the rise of the Islamic State, or Daesh, there's a grand debate as to whether or not we can use these same types of tools and paradigms to cut off the resources of what appears to be a growing movement, a metastasized terrorist group that has established itself a safe haven, a caliphate in the heart of the Middle East, but which is beginning to establish tentacles and outposts around the world. How can we disrupt their resources? How can we stop flows of funds to the group? And so issue after issue, you look at the national security debate, the question comes back to whether or not we can use alternatives to war, whether or not we can use American economic and financial power and influence. In many ways, where America still holds primacy and predominance around the world, to actually influence the end state of these core and very difficult and thorny national security issues. And so part of the reason I wrote the book was to explain why it is that that's the case. Why is it that these powers, which aren't new, right? Sanctions are not new. The use of economic blockades and financial and economic power is not new. Dating back to the Peloponnesian War, the idea of cutting off trade routes and commercial access was a part of how city-states or nations or even non-state actors thought about influencing and engaging in warfare or statecraft. And so this isn't really all that new in terms of a concept, how to use financial and economic resources as a way of influencing the environment or your enemy. But what is different in the 21st century is something quite important, I think, in terms of how we think about our national security. And much of this was born post 9/11, after the attacks here in New York and in Washington, where there was a perception that we had to use all elements of national power more creatively, more effectively, to not just prevent the next attack, but to try to undermine and undercut the movements that were driving the terrorism that was threatening the United States. And it was out of that strategy, out of that political push to think creatively about the use of national power, that we had the birth of a new era of financial warfare. And really, I think it's important to sort of deconstruct what happened in that post 9/11 period to understand what's happening today and, frankly, what's going to be coming in the future years. Because the back end of my book is dedicated to the coming financial wars, because I think we are really seeing just the birth of a new doctrine and a new era. But to understand all this, you have to understand what happened post 9/11 in this period. And what happened was this. There was a sense that the United States could use its financial and economic power more aggressively to go after terrorist financing. And that had several dimensions to it. In the first instance, there was a sense that we needed to understand better how rogue networks, terrorist groups, rogue regimes were actually raising, moving money, and also financing themselves. So there was a deep dependence on this new idea of finding financial intelligence. You often hear the terminology follow the money. That very much became a doctrine in the law enforcement and intelligence context. And so you had new institutions born within the government, new mandates to create new sources of financial intelligence. Everything from the pocket litter and receipts found in a terrorist safe house to the bank transfers and swift messaging that happens between major global banks. And to try to understand then the financial relationships and sometimes even the hidden relationships between the networks that were potentially threatening the United States. And so a whole new discipline, a whole new set of actors and new programs were established under this rubric of financial intelligence. So much so that it even has its own term now. It's called FININT, which goes along with the other forms of intelligence, human intelligence, signals intelligence, SIGINT, and others. So FININT was born. And the idea that you could understand threats, you could understand vulnerabilities, you could understand relationships by understanding financial relationships and financial data became central to how we thought about national security. Second, we thought aggressively about how to use financial tools, some old, some new, much more aggressively. Tools like the freezing of assets, the ability to outlaw doing any business with U.S. persons or companies, the ability to stop dollar transactions transiting through the U.S., the ability to minimize certain types of exports and to restrict certain types of commercial activities. All of this was part of a sense of using new economic tools and measures. A couple of tools are worth mentioning and keeping in mind. The first was an executive order that President Bush signed right after 9/11, called Executive Order 13224, signed on September 23rd, 2001. What's interesting about this was that it will go down as the first official response of the U.S. government to 9/11. It wasn't the invasion of Afghanistan, it wasn't the launching of a TLAM, it wasn't the arrest of Khalid Sheikh Mohammed. It was actually the signing of this executive order. And why was it important? Well, it was important because it was in some ways the financial battle plan, or at least the cornerstone for that battle plan, to use financial tools more aggressively against terrorism and those that were supporting terrorist activity. And what was really important about this was that for the first time it opened up the use of these tools to a broad range of terrorist actors, and not just terrorists like Osama bin Laden or Ayman al-Zawahiri, but also elements of their network and support mechanism to include those who were providing financial support or facilities to their organizations. And so suddenly it wasn't just that you could try to seize Osama bin Laden's accounts or try to hunt where particular terrorists had bank accounts or cash hidden, but it was about trying to affect the financial facilitation globally of these organizations. That meant banks were suddenly at risk. That meant money service businesses, hawaladars, hundi brokers, all were at risk. In addition, you had systemically a broadening and deepening of the anti-money laundering system. So a lot of the proposals that had been on the shelf for a long time around transparency, accountability, traceability were now at play. And so in the Patriot Act, which is now known as kind of the signature intelligence and law enforcement legislation passed post 9/11, you had a provision in there called Title III, a whole number of sections to it. It really was the broadest and most important expansion of the anti-money laundering system since its foundation with the Bank Secrecy Act. And what that did was it made banks and financial institutions, to include non-banks, things like insurance brokers and dealers in precious metals and stones, other types of financial brokers, suddenly subject to anti-money laundering rules and regulations. That meant they had to know their customers. They had to engage in transaction monitoring. They had to engage in customer due diligence. They had to have compliance systems and programs in place. And so suddenly now you had this broadening and deepening of the system, not just in the U.S., but internationally, with these norms now established through something called the Financial Action Task Force. And so you had these new tools emerging. You had this broadening and deepening of the system, and a sense that the system now had to be more transparent and accountable. You probably read, by the way, this series of articles in the New York Times recently, a five-part series about the use of shell companies and investment in real estate. It's an important discussion because it's part of that broader debate about how transparent, how accountable is the system, and how effective is it, right? So that's part of an ongoing debate. In addition, you had a tool in the Patriot Act that emerged. It's called Section 311. It's in that Title III that I described. That Section 311 gave the Secretary of the Treasury additional tools to identify what are called primary money laundering concerns. And so this, in essence, was the ability of the Secretary of the Treasury to designate a bank, a jurisdiction, or even a class of transaction, kind of a high-risk category of transactions, as primary money laundering concerns. The reason that's important is that it added to the ability of the Secretary of the Treasury to mark suspicious and problematic actors in the system and to say, look, you have to be wary and conscious of them. And in fact, in the maximalist use of this power,
you are therefore cut off from the U.S. financial system. You cannot do business here. And for those of you who know the banking world, you work here in New York perhaps, you know that if you can't transact in dollars, if you can't have a correspondent account with a New York bank or a U.S. bank, you are not going to function as a legitimate global bank. If you want to do business globally, you want to be a legitimate bank, you have to do business here in the U.S. and you have to play by our rules. And so this added to the tools in the toolkit. You then had, in this post-9/11 environment, not just focus on financial intelligence, not just new tools put on steroids, not just a broadening and deepening of the system, but you then had the enforcement of these laws and regulations, which in many ways had lain fallow for some time. And so banks were suddenly under a great deal of pressure. And you've seen the evolution of this in the newspapers. Major global banks coming under a great deal of regulatory pressure. The latest and last and biggest was the fine on BNP Paribas to the tune of almost $9 billion. And so what began post 9/11 was this emphasis on enforcing these rules and ensuring that there was at least some fidelity to their effective use. And so you had cases emerging, investigations of banks, investigations of money service businesses, investigations of groups that were tied to illicit financial flows beginning to emerge. The best example of this, and it's one I talk about in the book, and for those of you who are interested, I've got pictures in the book. And there's a picture of this example. I'll briefly describe it. Was the investigation of Riggs Bank. Riggs Bank was in Washington, a storied and established banking institution. It once called itself the most important bank and the most important capital of the world. Well, in 2005, it fell under the heavy pressure and gaze of regulatory and enforcement officers. So the role that they had played in the flow of funds from the Saudi embassy to some of the hijackers was under investigation by the FBI. Looking at some of the accounts that they had held for the Pinochet regime and his cronies was suddenly under scrutiny. Looking at how they were controlling embassy bank accounts across the board, in particular for kleptocracies and corruption-filled regimes like Equatorial Guinea, were now falling under heavy scrutiny. And their systems and controls in general were being scrutinized heavily by the regulators. And so in 2005, all of this was happening, and they were fined, not much actually in terms of the banking world, $25 million, which isn't much at all. But what happened was the reputational impact of all of that to them and to their business, to the notion of their financial integrity, was completely devastating. And so within a year, Riggs Bank, which had survived in Washington for decades as perhaps the most important banking institution that was local to the diplomatic community and to Washington society, was no more. And so the reputational weight of these enforcement actions, these heightened expectations, were suddenly beginning to impact. Banks knew that they were under scrutiny. Financial institutions knew they were under the gaze of law enforcement regulators. And so that began to impact the environment. And then finally, in this post-9/11 period, you had a new form of what I call financial diplomacy, a whole new set of actors that were at play in national security that hadn't been before. And so if you look at the pre-9/11 environment, the central actors in national security were all the ones that you know well, right? You can buy caps on the corner here for all the agencies, CIA, the FBI, State Department, the Pentagon. You know, those are the big boys and girls of national security. Post 9/11, with this emphasis on the use of financial tools and power, you actually had the Treasury Department having a seat at the table. And not just the Treasury Department, but also finance ministries around the world, central bank governors. Now you had G7 finance ministers, G20 finance ministers, putting out statements about financial regulation, countering terrorist financing, countering proliferation financing, WMD, countering money laundering. This was now a central agenda item for the chief financiers around the world. So much so that in the establishment of one of these financial intelligence programs that I described, the SWIFT program, which the New York Times revealed in 2006, which we call the Terrorist Financing Tracking Program. And by the way, I've got a couple chapters in the book about not only the creation of the program, but the revelation, which I think are very interesting. And I think the New York Times made a big mistake in revealing the program the way that they did. And their public editor, the ombudsman, agreed a couple months after their publication. But in any event...
Why do you think they made that mistake?
They made that mistake for three reasons. And let me put it in context for just a second, then I'll go back to the reason I raise it. The revelation came after the revelation of the NSA wiretap program. And the same reporters that were reporting on the SWIFT program were reporting on the NSA, had reported on the NSA program. Award-winning reporting, right? Pulitzer Prize-winning reporting. The central assumption of those reporters was that this program was just like that NSA program, that it was designed in the same way, that it had the same attributes, and in their minds was illegal. Nothing could be further from the truth. First of all, they weren't designed in parallel, so the design issue is not at play. It's completely legal under existing civil law, had been created cooperatively with SWIFT itself, had embedded in it from the very start privacy and civil liberties protections. And for the first time, in, to my knowledge, of any intelligence operation or program, actually had outside auditors and validators that not only on sort of an annual basis or a monthly basis would check the constraints on the use of the data and the protection of the data, but actually allowed the third party, SWIFT itself, to have real-time monitors ensuring that there was no misuse of the data beyond the parameters. So they would monitor the Treasury and other analysts that were using the data and could stop it in real time if they determined there was a problem in the use of the data. In addition, it was an incredibly effective program, and I give example after example. The finding of the capture of Hambali relied heavily on this data. Plot after plot that we disrupted, even through 2010, relied on pieces and parts of this data. And so it was incredibly effective. And finally, there was no sign of abuse at all. And the reality was that the people who designed it, I was one of them, we were in good faith trying to respect mightily the constraints, to the point that there was a lot of tension to try to use the data to do more. Nothing illegal, but to look at other national security risks. And we had agreed to not go beyond certain bounds, and we didn't. And so the problem with the New York Times revelation was the program was legal, it was effective, it was not being abused, it had privacy and civil liberties embedded in it, and they had the assumption that this was just another NSA program. And that's why the ombudsman on page, what, 823 or something, 2 months later, said that he had made a mistake, and they had made a mistake, he thought, in publishing the program. And I've got a whole chapter on that. So, but the point, the reason I raised the SWIFT program is it's an example of this new form of financial intelligence that I was talking about. But it's also another example of other actors coming to the table. And so this was the Treasury Department building an intelligence program, which prior to 9/11 was really anathema, was not really the way things operated. And importantly, it wasn't just the Treasury Department, it was Alan Greenspan and the central bank governors who oversaw the SWIFT program who actually were a part of its creation and oversight. And so whether it was Secretary O'Neill or Secretary Snow or Secretary Paulson, they took great comfort in the fact that Alan Greenspan thought the program was important, effective, and could be run without any cost or effect on the global financial system. So that's an example of new actors at the table. So you now have the Fed chairman centrally at the heart of one of these national security programs. More importantly, perhaps, is the fact that you now had private sector actors who were part of this discussion and landscape. And so it wasn't just that you had finance ministers around the world focused on this. It wasn't just that you had financial intelligence unit heads or central bank governors involved in some of this. You also then had bank CEOs, compliance officers, general counsels of the world's major companies and banks now engaged directly in worrying about whether or not their institutions were being misused by terrorists and other nefarious actors. And by that I mean they themselves were having to make a risk decision, a risk calculus, as to whether or not they were going to do business with certain actors in certain places with certain business lines, and to do so for their own purposes, not because a government necessarily told them to, or because of a UN Security Council resolution, but because the risk environment had changed. Post 9/11, it was just not acceptable to have a bank account in your bank of a known terrorist financier or of a group that was suspected by a legitimate government agency of being a terrorist organization. And so suddenly the banks themselves, to include these bankers, who've never really been a part of this discussion, suddenly having to make these decisions that had security implications around the world. And so all of that was part of this new environment, a new ecosystem that was more sensitive reputationally, that had at its heart the notion of denying illicit financing to illicit actors, and that had a whole new set of tools and players that were now in the mix. And what that did was it revealed a strategic opportunity. And that opportunity was interesting because it allowed us to think differently about how we used these powers. Because if you looked at the way sanctions have been used in the past, especially the trade sanctions of the 1970s, 80s, and 90s, these were sanctions that were largely hitched to diplomacy and diplomatic steps and activities. They were largely premised on the idea of trying to hermetically seal or embargo a country with certain exceptions that would permeate the program. And that really was about trying to change behavior by constricting trade with that particular country or regime. And perhaps it would work, perhaps it wouldn't. What changed here was that the ecosystem allowed for a different perspective. And that was that we could think about the use of American financial and economic predominance and primacy, the role of American capital markets, the centrality of Wall Street and New York in particular, the central role of the dollar as the chief trade and reserve currency around the world, and the role of the U.S., U.S. Treasury in particular, as sort of the standard setter around the world in terms of financial activity, seeing that all as pillars of power to then leverage and use in the national security domain. And to think then about not just how do we constrict whether or not Xerox copiers get into Tehran or whether or not Wrigley chewing gum finds its way onto the streets of Pyongyang, which is kind of the way trade sanctions used to work, but whether or not you could begin to unplug these actors and regimes that needed resources, that needed access to global finance, that needed access to global commerce to give life to their imaginings, to their agendas, could you unplug them from that system in a way that would choke their ability to do precisely that? Because strategically, the question wasn't whether or not you could stop every last dollar or yen or pound or euro, whatever, that goes to the last suicide bomb, because that's very difficult. We've seen that, we know that. And these terrorist attacks, Scott, as you remind me often, don't cost a lot. But the reality is that if you can constrain the reach and capabilities and resources of these organizations, you can begin to not just affect their behavior in the short term, but you can affect their strategic reach and capabilities long term. And so that's a different way of thinking about the use of 21st century global financial systems and commerce in a national security context. And that was the shift. And so the shift was really about that strategy. It was about thinking about how do you unplug these actors strategically from that system, and how do you constrain their ability to affect U.S. national security interests long term. And that had several components. That meant that what we were going to focus on was affecting the markets and the way that private actors, in particular, not just governments, how they thought about risk and how they determined with whom they did business. And so as I mentioned in the book, it was often after this period more important for Treasury officials to sit down with a bank CEO or a chief compliance officer than it was for them to sit down with their counterpart. Why? because what we were trying to impact was the decision-making of the private sector to understand the risks that they were taking to continue to do business with a group that might be affiliated with Al-Qaeda, or a front company that might be controlled by the Iranian Revolutionary Guard, or a trading company that was run by the North Korean regime behind two or three layers. And so the dynamic was to impact the private sector's decision to begin to unplug the access to the global financial and commercial order in an effective way. It also had the component of moving from sort of diplomatically driven sanctions. And these are sanctions that you've seen traditionally that go hand in hand with some broad international program. I mean, this is really at the heart of the way the League of Nations described the use of sanctions after World War I as a complement and as an accelerant to diplomacy. And that's right, of course. But these new forms of sanctions and financial measures really are about looking at the conduct, the illicit conduct of the targets at play. That is to say, we're worried about these activities and these actors, not just because they're dangerous, they might have a nuclear program, they may launch an attack on New York, but because they're engaged in illicit financial and commercial activity that's an actual threat to the financial system itself and its integrity. And so in defining that, in defining the illicit conduct, you begin to animate antibodies in the financial system. You say, look, they're not just a bad actor because we don't like them, or because we've got a diplomatic problem with them, but because they're actually engaged in activities that we shouldn't want to deal with anyway, and they should therefore be excluded. And so this became what's known now as a conduct-based approach to sanctions. That is to say, we're worried about actual terrorist financing, actual money laundering, actual proliferation financing, those activities that actually threaten the financial system and have a nexus, therefore, to national security. And then finally, this strategic notion that this is a power that, in some ways, can be a power unto itself. That when we think about the use of various national security tools, you often think about the extremes, and it's often binary, of diplomacy or warfare or kinetics. And what began to emerge was a sense that we could begin to develop this whole new range of tools in between, and in a way that would perhaps avoid war, and that would certainly give teeth to diplomacy, and doing so on a global scale, even absent broad international agreement, even absent some broad diplomatic agreement. And so that was this new ecosystem, that was the new strategy, and that was the thinking behind how we used it. Now let me give you an example, because that all sounds interesting theoretically maybe, hopefully interesting. But let me give you an example of how this worked in practice. And this example is important because it was actually the moment of awakening within the U.S., within the national security community, as to a new form of power that had evolved. Because a lot of this was happening kind of sub rosa. It was not really sort of well understood or known, even within the government, as to how this power and how this environment was shifting. But what happened in 2005 was something very interesting. And we had started something back in 2003 at the Treasury to look at where we had the nexus of what I just described. Where do we have a nexus of illicit financial activity that's a real threat to the global financial system, but that also has a clear nexus to core national security concerns? So we began to look at what we call just bad banks. Banks that were doing all sorts of business and transactions for America's enemies. And so we began to use this Section 311 power that I talked about to identify primary money laundering concerns, to say, look, this is what these banks are doing illegally, and this is what the U.S. Banking community and financial community needs to do to no longer do business or to excise them from the legitimate financial world. And so we did a bunch. There was a bank in Cyprus tied to Russian organized crime. The Commercial Bank of Syria that was helping Saddam Hussein evade sanctions was engaged in terrorist financing. Didn't have anti-money laundering controls. banks controlled by the United Wa Army and the Golden Triangle in Southeast Asia, all sorts of banks that we identify that were problematic and allowing access to the financial system to these bad actors. And we, of course, were looking at North Korea and Iran and others. And what was interesting about North Korea was that, in some ways, it provided sort of a prime set of targets. Now, if you look at sanctions through the traditional lens as I described it, as is often said in Washington, even today, to this day, there's often sort of the orthodoxy that there's not much else you can do to a country like North Korea. Right? We don't trade with them. We don't let their leaders come shop in New York. They don't have bank accounts in the U.S. And so what are we going to do to North Korea commercially or from a trade perspective? Well, that's kind of right. But what's wrong about that is it doesn't take into account the financial map and the reliance of the North Korean regime on the global financial and commercial order. And so if you looked at the financial map, and we did, to see where North Korea had financial relationships, it had banking relationships all around the world, to include in Russia, China, Hong Kong, Macau, Mongolia, Vietnam. They even had their own bank in Vienna. It's called Golden Star Bank. And what do they use these banking relationships for? To acquire material, to move money, and in most cases, to engage in illicit financial activity. They even have an intelligence office called Office 39 that's dedicated to raising funds and finding ways of getting that money back to the regime. Money that's significant, hundreds of millions of dollars the regime then uses for its programs and to pay its military and the rest. And so, if you looked at the map, it was actually very different. And what was known as the Hermit Kingdom, which if you look at the satellite imagery at night looks awful dark, had all sorts of interesting connections internationally to these banks. And there was one bank in particular, Banco Delta Asia in Macau. And for those of you who don't follow this stuff closely, Macau is now the casino capital of the world, the gambling capital of the world, far outstripping Las Vegas, pun intended. But in any event, this small bank, private bank, was being used for all sorts of purposes by the North Koreans. Now, the other thing that was interesting about this relationship and what the North Koreans were doing was that they were not just engaged in the development of a nuclear program that we were obviously worried about, but they were also engaged in all sorts of illicit financial activity, going back to this conduct set of issues that I was talking about. And so this is a regime that's known by many as the mafia state, called by some the soprano state, because they actually like the Sopranos. They've got the DVD set. And they act like it, and they run a criminal operation to raise funds like a mafia organization. And so they engage in drug trafficking. So they do that with heroin, methamphetamine, other types of drugs. They do that in coordination with Asian organized crime groups and others. They engage in counterfeit cigarette sales. And so the tobacco companies chase them all around the world. FBI, Secret Service too sometimes. They engage in proliferation finance, so they sell a lot of their weapons technology and nuclear program technology. Keep in mind that the Syrian program that the Israelis destroyed was being built by the North Koreans. And so this whole font of sources of illicit finance. And for purposes of the U.S. Treasury at the time, significantly, they were the best and most important counterfeiter of U.S. $100 bills. Known by the Secret Service as the supernote, because it's so good. And I guarantee you if I passed a supernote around here, you wouldn't tell the difference. You wouldn't be able to tell the difference. The only folks who can tell a difference, even those of you who handle lots of $100 bills, I can see skeptical faces in the crowd, are the Secret Service agents who have the equipment to detect the anomalies, and they're not many. And sometimes money exchange operators who can actually feel the difference. Which is fascinating. The first supernote was found in Manila by a money exchange operator. So the supernotes appeared all around the world, wherever the North Koreans have been diplomatically or engaging in commercial activity. So in Yemen, Peru, Taiwan, even Las Vegas, it's popped up. And so the Secret Service hunts that down and keeps an eye on it. So this is an all-purpose sort of illicit financial regime. And so in many ways, given this new paradigm, almost a perfect target. And the small bank, almost a perfect private sector target. It wasn't controlled by the Chinese government, which would have created some diplomatic tensions, of course, but it was an important cog in this set of relationships that the North Koreans had. So we set out to use Section 311 against this bank, because it was a bad bank. It was a primary money laundering concern, all legitimate. But it also mattered to our national security. And the whole point of the strategy was to find those areas where the U.S. Treasury could, using its unique powers, find a way of unplugging key actors and enemies of the U.S. from the global financial commercial order. So it took about 2 years through the interagency process. Those of you who are interested in government and bureaucracy, it's a great story around that, where everyone had to get comfortable, had to understand what was going to happen, and had to be sure that there wasn't negative externalities or problems that would result from it. And so the intelligence community had to get comfortable. They didn't want there to be a revelation of what we knew about what the North Koreans were doing, so they were comfortable. The FBI and Secret Service, who were investigating some cigarette smuggling rings tied to organized crime on the West Coast and the East Coast, had to feel comfortable. And so we had to wait for the takedown at a wedding in New Jersey, no joke, for this to move forward, because that was the grand takedown of these rings. By the way, if I can remember the names of the operations, I think it was Smoking Dragon and Royal Charm were the two cases going on at the time.
There's a story on the wedding, you said?
What's that?
There actually, I can read a story on the wedding.
Yes, you can. You can. And I think the East Coast case was Royal Charm. The West Coast was Smoking Dragon. And they were both, FBI and Secret Service were running parts of the investigation. And I write about it in the book, but there's other media coverage.
Thank you.
I think Vanity Fair has an article on it, too. So in any event, so we had to wait for the law enforcement folks to be comfortable. That happened. And obviously, we had to wait for the diplomats to get comfortable. We had to keep in mind the six-party talks happening at the time. A lot of concern over whether or not this set of actions or the 311 would destroy the nuclear talks. And so they eventually got comfortable. Chris Hill came on board. He was the assistant secretary for these issues. He was comfortable with the action. The military had to understand what was going on, but they had less equities. And the military was interesting, because I would go to these meetings for almost like 2 years, and they would ask serious and important questions, but they're usually the same, which was, well, how many assets are we going to freeze? And I'd say, well, none, probably. And they'd say, well, what businesses are we going to shut down, or what are we going to close? And I'd say, well, we're not going to close anything, because we're not talking about any businesses in the U.S., really. They'd say, well, are we going to affect, you know, is there something that we're going to touch or affect? And they'd say, no, we're not going to touch or kinetically impact anything. So not much Treasury can do in that field anyway. So they look quizzically like, what are we doing? What are we talking about then? And the reality was, in this new ecosystem that I described, in this new environment, with the use of American primacy, the use of a Treasury tool, the ability to actually designate a financial institution as a pariah, and to say, look, this pariah, because of what it's doing, can no longer do business with the U.S. or in the U.S. That was a financial death penalty. And so in September 2005, what you had, when we released what was a domestic regulation, it wasn't even a final regulation, it was a proposed rule, was what Mike Hayden, who was then director of the CIA, prior to that, director of the NSA, called the 21st century version of a precision-guided financial missile. Because what happened was, we launched the regulation. Again, only had impact in the U.S., wasn't tied to the U.N., wasn't tied to what the Chinese were doing, anything. But it immediately killed the bank. The bank could no longer do business in dollars, could no longer do business in the U.S. There was a run on the bank, people trying to get their money out. The Macanese Monetary Authority took it over immediately. All the North Korean accounts there were frozen. And in essence, the bank died a pretty quick death. But what was more significant was what happened beyond the bank. And I think this was the real awakening for people, because it was the market effect and the ripple effect and the reaction to doing business with anything that had North Korean implications that was most dramatic. And so banks in Vietnam, in Mongolia, in Beijing, in Hong Kong started to close their North Korean accounts. They started to freeze assets. They started to block transactions. They started to ask hard questions of those North Korean agents that were trying to wire money or engage in lines of credit or trying to open new accounts. And so slowly but surely you had the North Koreans locked out of the global financial system and no longer had access to all those tentacles that they once relied on. And it took them about 3 weeks to figure it out. Initially, they always sort of put out a statement and say, look, this is American imperial action, and they usually poo-poo whatever we do. And that happened here too. But 3 weeks later, they had a different attitude. And it was the first time in modern memory that they called the White House and the State Department first to say, we have a problem, we have to talk. And for about 2 years thereafter, every conversation started and ended with, we want our money back. And really what they wanted back was not, actually, interestingly, just $25 million that were frozen in Bangladesh. Again, not a lot. But what it represented was their being locked out of the system. They wanted back into the system. They wanted access to their bank accounts. They wanted access to credit lines. They wanted to be able to trade. They wanted to be able to do business. And they couldn't do it anymore. And so one of the North Korean negotiators in the middle of all this told the White House negotiator at the time, in a moment probably he probably shouldn't have said it, but he said, you finally found a way to hurt us. And so the reality was not just a moment of awakening for the North Koreans, but for the American side as well. Something different had happened here. This was a different use of financial tools and measures and campaigns to actually add leverage to our diplomacy. And that began then a whole new rethinking within the national security community as to how we thought about the use of these tools. It began then the debate around how we use this tool and this strategy against Iran. And so what emerged was in essence the same playbook, but in some ways multiplied and made more sophisticated in the Iranian context. The first set of targets were Iranian banks engaged in illicit conduct. Bank Sadarat, the chief terrorist financier and source of support from Tehran to Beirut for purposes of Hezbollah. Banks Meli and Malat that were chief proliferation sources and financial facilities for the regime. Those were next. The Postal Bank, and then even ultimately Bank Markazi, the central bank of Iran, were targets. President Obama issuing the Section 311, primary money laundering concern designation, against the central bank of Iran. And so the banks became sort of the first line of target and began to get unplugged from the system. Then you had the insurance sector targeted. The Iranians needed insurance to do business. And slowly but surely, the insurance companies around the world, the Germans, the British, and others that had been providing all the insurance that the commercial actors, to include the Revolutionary Guard, needed to do business around the world, began to pull their coverage and their activities.
But not Lloyd's.
Lloyd's.
Lloyd's continued to do business with Iran.
Well, hold on. Let me finish the story. We'll talk about the nuance of this, because there are different layers to this. I don't represent Lloyd's, so don't get mad at me. So that began. It's not complete. I agree with you. And there are dimensions of the banking unplugging that's not complete either, and I'm happy to talk about the nuance. But in the insurance context, they began to withdraw. And again, it wasn't necessarily because there was a mandate. A lot of this was their own risk calculus in terms of who they wanted to do business with and how they wanted to do business, which gets to some of the variations we're talking about. And so that happened. And so interestingly, you began to see Iranian shipments getting stopped in harbor. Not because you had some naval blockade outside of Hong Kong or Rotterdam or Singapore, but because the shipper couldn't demonstrate that they had insurance for the shipments to actually allow them to pull out of port or even to come into port. And so you had a 21st century version of a naval blockade that emerged because of a lack of access to insurance. You then had looking at how to disrupt trade and finance tied to oil, which was the final dimension of this. And so that happened, and you had Congress and the European Union very much getting into this, which after 2010, 2011, 2012, with the administration and Congress sort of pushing, the oil embargo sort of put on top. And finally, kind of a cherry on top of the strategy was the European Union actually driving the unplugging of the designated uranium banks, not all uranium banks, but designated uranium banks, from the SWIFT bank messaging system. I mentioned SWIFT earlier in terms of the terrorist financing tracking program. The reason SWIFT's important is it's the consortium that provides the bank messaging for all the banks in the world. It's basically the banking switchboard for the world. And so if you want to do banking, not just in the U.S., but just banking anywhere, you need access to this for the most part. There are other ways of doing it, but it's really the most effective and efficient. And so the final step was unplugging the Iranian banks from that messaging system. And so I call this the constriction campaign, because over the years, what you had was an isolation of the Iranian institutions and facilities and ability to access capital, which when added to the mismanagement of its own government, now the drop in oil prices and other factors really has constrained the Iranian economy and I think forced Rouhani and others to think about making the deal. And so that has become in some ways the playbook. And you've seen that now translated into the Russian context. How do you apply these same tools and principles in a way in the Russian context? With the distinction here that you have a much bigger economy, a G20 economy, you have one that has capital and resource connectivity and dependencies with Europe in particular that are much deeper than anything that Iran ever had or North Korea. And you also have the concern of blowback or boomerang effects of anything that's done economically that may hurt struggling European economies and the global economy. And so if you look at the construct of the Russian program, it's actually very creative because it's an attempt to chill the willingness of banks and investors to do business in Russia. And it's designed not necessarily to designate all Russian banks, though some are designated for certain purposes, but it's intended to affect the market decisions as to whether or not people should or want to do business in or with Russia. And that, again, in combination with economic mismanagement, dropping oil prices, has staggered the Russian economy. And so issue after issue, crisis after crisis, it's this paradigm and playbook relying on the primacy of American power that really has been at play. And in some ways, the central tool that we've used to deal with some of these crises. Because most folks that I know don't want to go to war. Certainly don't want to go to war with North Korea, don't want to go to war with Russia, don't want to go to war with Iran. Frankly, it's not a good proposition for lots of reasons. So what's the alternative? Can we change behavior? Can we change the decision calculus through the use of this other form of power and influence? Now, there are challenges to this. And as I allude to in the back end of the book, you know, there's more to this story than just what the U.S. does, because the targets and the environment and the ecosystem is constantly adapting and shifting. You have others in the system, like the Russians, like the Chinese, learning and understanding how they perhaps can use vulnerabilities of others, to include the United States, as weapons and as tools and as strategies. And as I wrote in the Financial Times recently, one of the things we have to be conscious of is in escalating the economic pressure on Russia, whether or not Russia begins to think more aggressively about the use of its own resource and economic and even cyber tools as a way of asymmetrically impacting, if not messaging back toward the West, to use those tools as both a sword and a shield in a new form of financial warfare. And so China and Russia thought about this. And if you're not convinced of that, I lay out a story in the book. This is a story that was conveyed to Hank Paulson, who was then Secretary of the Treasury, about a Russian proposition to the Chinese. And the proposition was this. This was in the summer of 2008, at the height of the financial crisis, with markets crumbling, with fragility at its height, and with concerns in terms of, in particular, the mortgage backed security market here in the US. The Russians proposed to the Chinese that they collectively and en masse and at the same time dump their holdings in Freddie and Fannie to try to further disrupt and undermine faith and confidence in the US capital markets and in particular the mortgage backed security markets. So at the height of fragility and potential breakdown, you had the Russians actually proposing it. Now, the Chinese didn't go along with it, fortunately. But as the story was told, it was a serious proposition. And to me, that's a real interesting window into how others may begin to think about the use of financial ties and vulnerabilities and the role of global financial and commercial systems to their advantage. And so that's part of the reason I've talked about coming financial wars, because there really is, I think, a new domain of warfare, statecraft, national security influence that has at its core economic and financial powers and measures. And part of our challenge is how do we preserve those powers? How do we ensure that we're not reaching a tipping point, Peter, as you and I have talked about, with the markets, with the banks, where the de-risking that's happening, because they're so afraid that suddenly you don't have any legitimate actors doing business in certain parts of the world or with certain actors or with certain communities like the Somali American or the Somali British communities. So what do we do to temper the use of these powers when the instinct actually is to use them as aggressively and as often as possible? In part because they seem to work, and in part because what else is there to do, right? If we can't talk somebody to the table or to death, and we're not going to bomb or invade them, so the lore goes, we need to use strong financial tools and measures. And this is what's animating the debate over Russia today. Fareed Zakaria has even just come out with his support over the idea of unplugging the Russian banks from SWIFT, as in the case of Iran. I think it's a bad idea, and in fact, the Russians have now said twice openly, last time in Davos, they would consider that an act of war. So we have entered this new era of financial warfare. It's now with us, it's upon us, and we're seeing the formation of new doctrines, strategies, and tactics that take this into account. And the last thing I would say in this regard is, this isn't a field that is sort of confined unto itself. These are tools and measures that in some ways can be combined with other forms of statecraft or warfare or other forms of pressure and suasion. And so this is a power and a strategy unto itself, but it's a form of intelligence, financial intelligence that we talk about. It's a form of military power. The military actually calls this something different. They call it threat finance. It's now taught in the military academies and at NDU and these places. It's called threat finance. It's thought of in diplomatic circles in different ways, but it's understood to give teeth to our diplomacy. Law enforcement thinks of these tools differently. You have organizations like the DEA using these tools aggressively to complement things that they've done. So I lay out a story in the book about Hezbollah money laundering operation that was global in scope to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars, relying on banking relationships with the Lebanese Canadian Bank in Beirut and in Canada, and the use of used car dealerships in the US and ties to drug trafficking rings in South America and West Africa. The DEA broke some of this up, but guess what? They can't arrest everybody who's a part of that global network. What did they do? They relied on the Section 311 action on the Lebanese Canadian Bank, which destroyed Lebanese Canadian Bank and put enormous pressure on the Beirut banking system. And so it's a form of intelligence, military power, diplomacy, law enforcement, It's also a form of cyber warfare. And I think one of the things to watch in the coming years is the convergence of financial power and measures with cyber tools and warfare. And I think you're already seeing it, without a doubt. The JP Morgan breach is an important case study where 76 million households and their accounts were affected. Still not clear whether or not all of the malware and activity, perhaps even Trojan horses, have been exfiltrated from the system or identified. And a question in the Oval Office by President Obama to his national security team. Do we know if this is President Putin sending us a message? Is this the Russians behind this attack? And the answer to him being, we don't know. And so the reality is we're facing a new period of warfare where we have asymmetric dimensions and vulnerabilities, where our enemies have adapted and understood and learned from us, and where the environment is growing more complicating and, I would say, more interesting. It's a more dangerous world, perhaps, Scott, but it's one that presents opportunities if we think creatively. And what's empowering about this this doctrine, this new field, is that we're not talking about physical warfare. We are talking about how to influence our international and national security interests in a way that leverages the power that we have. And understanding how to do that strategically well, with the proper caution, with the proper consideration for privacy, civil liberties, for the understanding of balance of power, is still all in formation. And so that's why I wrote the book. That's why I love this space. And I hope you you get into it in some form or fashion, at least reading the newspaper and understanding the latest sanctions or the latest diplomacy a bit better. So thank you very much. What had happened internationally. But he was beginning to look to new models. And the model that he was most interested in was kidnap for ransom, because it was seen to be so lucrative. The Taliban was proving very profitable with it. And Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb was making a fortune out of it. The reason I mention that is because what you've had over time is an adaptation by Al-Qaeda, its formal affiliates, and even its cells and others that like to wave the banner of these groups, even if they're not formally attached to them. They've learned to adapt to the international pressure that was put on it. And so what the model is now is to find ways of leveraging local economies, perhaps even local criminality, local opportunities, to actually raise and move money. In some cases, some of these groups, and you've seen this with some of the long-standing terrorist groups or militant groups like the FARC or even the Taliban, move into kind of a for-profit militancy model where they're running drugs, they're running mining operations. You have that with like Nasalites in India, where they're actually kind of, they're like businessmen, really. With a, you know, an AK-47 on their back, but they're really kind of just businessmen or mafiosos. ISIS is a little bit of that, because they've learned to run a war economy. And that has meant sort of taking advantage of the physical space they control. And so that's meant oil revenue, which we've tried to disrupt aggressively with some of the air assault. They were running the extraction, even the refinery, the movement, and then the trade. They developed mobile refineries, and they were finding ways of even selling money back to the Assad regime. And so they were very creative, because they would take the profit from the extraction, they would charge for security for the transport, and then they'd make the deal for the actual sale at the checkpoint with the Syrian regime. So that was a major source of revenue, much less so now. You've seen this now. The UN just acted on some of this. There's been some good reporting, in particular the Wall Street Journal recently, about the antiquities trade, something I've been talking about for a while. They began their operations by merely taxing at one-fifth the value of the looted antiquities. They realized, you know what, we can make more money by just running the operations ourselves. So they hired archaeologists, maybe some anthropologists, Scott, I don't know, maybe hopefully no one you know. They brought in some bulldozers and began to run the operations themselves. And so literally pulling, you know, vases and pulling walls down from sacred sites and things, and selling it for dollars. They've engaged in kidnap for ransom, clearly. Often, you know, horrifically, not worrying about the profit, but using the hostages as strategic pawns, and we've seen the horrific results of that. And then some local sort of criminality, and then obviously extortion and taxes. The extortion and taxes is not new. That's a model that's been used, for example, by the Al-Shabaab movement that has controlled territory for some time, so they run checkpoints and they tax and extort. The Al-Shabaab movement, by the way, which is in Somalia, at one point controlled the port of Kismaya. They no longer do. The Kenyans took that away from them, which was very important. Another reason why Al-Shabaab doesn't like Kenya and why you have things like the Westgate Mall attack, etc. But they were very smart because what they were doing was they were out-competing the port of Mogadishu. So it was actually cheaper to take your goods into Kismayo versus Mogadishu. So there was this arbitrage, and they were actually seen as pretty good business interlocutors. And so I haven't answered your question yet, but I want to describe the landscape because the adaptations are significant because all these different groups and factions have embedded themselves into the locality and figured out ways to make money. And Al-Qaeda in Maghreb is sort of the most proficient at the kidnap for ransom. They've really made that in industry, and it's a real problem. And you've heard it from the Treasury Department for a number of years, saying that that's a real problem in terms of terrorist funding. In terms of tools to counter this, the interesting thing with terrorist financing is that, or even any form of criminality, is at some point it reaches scale, so that it has to touch elements of the financial system that the U.S. government can impact, or U.S. government and its allies can impact, and so. At some point, the ISIS economy touches brokers. It touches the Turkish economy. It touches the Kurdish economy. You have people who are brokering for them. You have money service businesses perhaps wiring money or taking their cash. You maybe even have banks with branches along the Turkish-Syrian border, for example, opening accounts or running accounts. That have ties to these brokers and these relationships. And so you can impact those. You can try to isolate them, identify them, shut them down, freeze the assets. But what makes this more difficult is that when groups have a safe haven and they're running a local economy, at the end of the day, you have to physically dislodge them. I mean, that's what the Kenyans did with Al-Shabaab and Kismayo. You literally had to fight them out of control of a major economic resource. And I think that's... It's been a bit of a challenge for people to understand that because in the campaign against Al-Qaeda, there was such a sense that the campaign had worked and we had used these sort of unique tools in an interesting way. So I was getting lots of calls over the last year, people saying, well, can't we do the same thing that we did to Al-Qaeda? And it was almost as if people wanted us to push like a magic button in New York or Washington and say, okay, now ISIS doesn't have resources. But the reality is if a group has territory, they have resources in that territory and are developing and using, leveraging an economy that relies on that, you're going to have to physically dislodge them at some point. Now, an interesting question here, too, is they control a vast swath of Iraqi territory, to include Mosul, where the banks are still open. So an open question here is what's happening with and through those banks, and how has the international community tried to isolate those activities? I'm still waiting for an answer to that. I haven't been to Mosul myself recently, so I don't know what the answer is, but we'll just have to see. But some of the tools are effective still. Some of them are not, because you've got these local war economies operating. Yes, sir?
Considering the United States' debt, does this have any adverse effects on our effectivity in financial warfare?
It's a great question. I think there's certain long-term dimensions to our economic and financial power that are important to keep in mind. So as I said, part of the reason all this works is that in some ways the U.S. still retains its predominance in the global financial and commercial order, even though our economy is now more competitive with other economies, and the Chinese economy is growing larger, et cetera. But there are certain fundamental dimensions to our power that are important. One is the role of the dollar. And so the health of the dollar is critical. And that has to be tended to. And it's often in this context, sort of an afterthought to the strategic discussion. But clearly, folks at the Treasury Department, at the Fed, are thinking in these terms. Second, it's the health of our economy, generally, and the strength and size of it. Because part of the reason these things work is that people want to do business here. They have to do business here. And they're attracted to doing business here. And so that is an important component of this. And then finally, sort of the long-term fundamentals. Our debt, our politics, our rule of law are all critical. I mean, one of the differentiators between the U.S. economy and the Chinese economy long-term is that the Chinese economy still hasn't answered some fundamental questions about rule of law, transparency, capital flows, and frankly, the role of its currency. So even though the renminbi is becoming more of a trade currency, most experts say, look, it will never become a predominant currency. It will never really challenge the dollar or the basket of other currencies until some of these fundamentals about its system are understood and resolved. And so those fundamental elements, which are frankly just important for our national health, are really important for the use of these powers. The other thing I would say, which is a little bit of the flip side, I also think that how we use this power and the perception of its use becomes very important. I mentioned earlier this notion of a tipping point, where there's a sense of maybe you can overuse the power in a way. You could begin, this power seems to be a hyper use of our extraterritorial sort of reach. And I've had lots of discussions recently with diplomats, Europeans in particular, especially after the BNP Paribas fine, saying, look, this feels to us like just American hegemony run wild in the financial space. And why are you telling us what rules to follow? And why is a French bank being fined by New York authorities and having to follow OFAC Treasury rules that may not even be our rules? How does this work, right? So you may have kind of a reverse impact if you're not careful about how you use it strategically. Yes, ma'am, and then we'll go here.
That's somewhat of a two-pronged question. In terms of international relations, when, especially after 9/11, when we traced the funding of Al-Qaeda and how they were moving their money and what their means were, there was an issue with a lot of less economically stable states and using their banks. So we put in all these sanctions and everything internationally, and that's affecting a lot of smaller banks and less stable countries because they can't meet security requirements because they don't have the money to do so.
Yeah.
And it's locking them out of the international industry. So what does that mean in terms of foreign policy implications? And the second half of the question is, Al-Qaeda was really strong in terms of getting into mosques and manipulating the Islamic obligation to tithe or give to a charity. So how do you do that when the money's essentially going through a mosque and charitable foundations, especially when they've been, I think they've infiltrated up to 60-something% of mosques internationally? So not even Al-Qaeda, but just any organized crime like that. How do you deal with something like that, and what are the international implications? Because now you're mixing church and state.
Yeah.
Can you summarize the question?
Sure.
Sorry.
No. Two questions. They're distinct. First is, how do you explain or talk about, correct me if I'm wrong, the implications of all of this, and sanctions in particular, on smaller and mid-sized banks and economies, especially in the developing world?
Right.
That in some ways are getting locked out of the financial system because they can't meet these higher standards and such. So that's a great question. So let me answer that first. It's an issue. It's an issue in two ways. One, you have this not as a mandate of government, but as, in essence, an organic effect of this environment that I was describing. And you're seeing this most now. If you talk to sort of an anti-money laundering expert or in the banking world, this is playing out in the context of correspondent banking relationships. And the question is, can major global banks, which are under a great deal of regulatory and enforcement scrutiny, assure themselves that their correspondent relationships or the banks that they're dealing with in, let's say, Zimbabwe or in East Africa, have in place the types of compliance and controls that they need to ensure that they feel comfortable that the money coming from there or transaction through there is actually not illicit in some form, right? Are there the checks and balances? That's a major issue. It's information now, and And there's a real debate as to what that looks like and what are the development and long-term economic implications. So in some ways, I think the banking community, the Wolfsburg group of major global banks, are going to have to either singly or in combination figure out what those rules are, because governments aren't going to provide those rules. You have groups like FATF providing guidelines and such, but it's not enough to dictate sort of where they do business and how they do business. So that is going to have to be in some ways a self-regulating fix to the question. The broader policy question is a really important and deep one, which is these are all strategies of financial exclusion. What happens when these strategies of financial exclusion are less effective because you haven't considered financial inclusion, or actually are detrimental to the public policy goals and good of financial inclusion? So I was talking about the Somali communities in the U.S. and Britain and elsewhere earlier. That's a very good example, because what you have is banks making what appear to be very rational risk-based decisions about not wanting to do business with money service businesses in Somalia, right? Can you check the kind of money coming through a Western Union-like company out of Somalia? Are you dealing with a pirate? Are you dealing with a criminal? Are you dealing with a terrorist? Is this run by Al-Shabaab? I don't know, right? So the banks are saying, we don't even want to worry about it. It's not worth the cost, and so we're going to exit. Sounds rational, reasonable in the context of these financial exclusion strategies, but in terms of financial inclusion, it's a disaster. Because what are you doing? You're excising an entire set of community, a diaspora community, that's critical to, as an economic lifeline to Somalia. And oh, by the way, you're forcing probably some sort of market adaptation which moves those money flows outside of what are relatively well-regulated channels, perhaps into unregulated cash movements or other less visible ways of moving money. So are we actually harming the greater good because of that? That's a debate in formation. I've got suggestions and recommendations that I make to all sorts of folks, but that's a debate that people are having as we speak, and something that's affecting businesses as we speak. So you're absolutely right. At some point, this has to evolve to a place where financial inclusion and exclusion are thought of collectively, and we're not cutting off our nose to spite our face, despite the effectiveness of some of these tools. So the second question, remind me again, was, how do you deal with NGOs and charities and the fact that Al-Qaeda has used zakat, the obligation under one of the pillars of Islam, to fund itself or to acquire funding? That was basically, yeah. Right? That's a very difficult thing. I got a whole chapter on this in the book. There's a technical answer, which is, well, it's pretty straightforward. You kind of try to find and map what those charities are, who the people are, and you identify them, you freeze their assets, you shut them down. And we did a lot of that post 9/11. We actually ended up with the Saudi government shutting down the largest charity out of Saudi Arabia, Al-Haramain, for precisely that reason, right? So that's fairly rote. You create norms and rules and laws around this, and so you see from the Financial Action Task Force obligations to regulate the NGO sector and to have the same sort of anti-money laundering systems there. In the U.S., you have the IRS that audits and does enforcement. Treasury had also put out what were called voluntary guidelines in terms of due diligence that NGOs should be doing, especially those working in conflict zones or in crisis regions that were potentially susceptible. And so all that kind of is understood and it's cooperation with between government and the private sector to understand where the risks are. The more difficult question is, well, how do you deal with the sensitivities around this? One, in not chilling donor goodwill. Right? Because we do not want to stop charitable giving. And so, in a sense, the whole idea of deterrence around terrorist financing is antithetical to advocating for the goodwill of donations. Again, the problem here is that groups like Al-Qaeda have taken full advantage of the cloak of goodwill around donations to their advantage. And so they play off of this. They understand the use and utility. Second, you have religious sensitivities to your question and point. Does this start to really affect that? And I think, you know, in the conversations with Saudis, the Saudis in particular, this grows very difficult because one of the things that we found was during the Hajj, the religious pilgrimage, it would be not just a moment of religious obligation, but it would also be an opportunity that a lot of these groups would take to go raise funds. And so you'd have the Taliban or Al-Qaeda or other elements coming into Saudi Arabia under the guise of being a religious pilgrim. And maybe they did do the Hajj. But they also used the time as a roadshow to raise funds for their militant cause. And so what do you do about that? Are we going to be dictating to the Saudis who they let in for the Hajj, which is again yet another pillar of Islam? You know, that gets a very touchy and diplomatically sensitive. So these are delicate issues, but I think the reality is, and the awareness that grew post 9/11 was that many of the charities had been infiltrated, some were being used to raise funds, and that the charities themselves were serving as ideological outposts for the recruitment of operatives, as well as sort of the ideological preparation and the funding around this. And so the discussion and the dialogue around the controls around the world in terms of those activities became an important part of what we did. And that conversation has continued with Kuwait, Qatar, in Pakistan, in Afghanistan, and globally, because it still remains an issue. And frankly, even more so now in the context of Syria, where people of good faith want to give money to Syrian refugees and for causes to deal with the incredible human suffering. But the reality is you've got groups like Jabhat al-Nusra and Ahrar al-Sham and Daesh that are taking advantage of some of those same charitable channels. And so in some ways, we've seen this movie before, and it's playing out in some fairly aggressive ways in Syria. And it's a hard problem. Yes, ma'am, you had a question earlier.
Yes, what's the consequence of civil litigation in this, in particular, the Arab Bank case in New York?
It's a great question. I allude to this. I don't get much into this in the book, but I allude to it. Which is the role of private litigants, and civil litigants, in particular victims of terror and the families of victims of terror, either under the ATA or other provisions that allow them to sue individuals or entities that were part of a terrorist attack or had facilitated it. And it's significant because there have been a number of cases, not all successful, but a number that have really tempered the market, so to speak. And what's important about the Arab Bank case, as you describe it, for those who aren't aware, this was a case that alleged that the Arab Bank, based in Amman, Jordan, had not engaged in proper due diligence or controls around Hamas-related accounts and other terrorist suspect accounts. And had not done proper due diligence and had continued to bank known terrorist actors or those that they should have known were tied to terrorist activity. The jury found that Arab Bank was guilty, and that was an incredibly significant finding for a couple reasons. One, it found the bank simply because it had bank accounts for a terrorist organization or those associated with it was guilty and was liable to the victims. And so that in and of itself was important because you had a financial institution, a rather major one in the Middle East, that's now subject to this judgment. But from a compliance perspective, what was important too is that you had the bank suddenly now liable, not because it didn't check the OFAC list or some government list that said, this is a terrorist, don't do business with them. They were now liable because they, on their own, didn't do further homework. They didn't do the kind of due diligence that would have said, look, we've got bank accounts for these individuals. They're not listed or prohibited persons under U.S. law or European law or other law, but we know that they're tied to these groups and individuals that are. And in doing that homework and due diligence, we should not do business with them. And so in some ways, it moved the requirement for due diligence one step further in the sanctions context, which had largely been defined as check the list and don't do business with the bad actors that are listed. Now this is something further than that. And that has begun to reshape the way that banks are thinking about compliance and due diligence, and in some ways has made their lives more complicated, but also really marks a key watermark of the role of private litigation, to your point, in holding banks accountable or at least shaping the environment around banks' activities with or around terrorist organizations. So that I think in the history of this will go down as an incredibly important and landmark case in shaping the environment even further as you see all these other more official fines happening on financial institutions. Bear in mind the Bank of China is next. There's a major civil litigation and case going on around whether or not the Bank of China did business with some of these actors. It has already caused a diplomatic row between China and Israel. And you're going to see this play out in some fairly dramatic and interesting ways. And for those of you who are students or are interested in this space, I would commend to you watching that case as it evolves, because it's going to create all sorts of interesting permutations and tensions. Yes, Charles.
One question. What do you feel about, two questions. First is, what do you feel about the ethical issues of the of population suffering from imposing various kinds of sanctions? And how do you grapple with that, particularly in a, from a policy point of view? The other question is a little more philosophical. The all of these financial instruments have it there. They really assume that we operate as rational actors. And if you take away enough money and we suffer enough, then we won't do bad things, whether you're the mafia, whether you're the Taliban, whether you're whatever. Whereas it seems to me in some crucial, in there you've given lots of examples where it's really quite effective and quite potentially valuable. But if you take the example of, well, historically, the rise of the Nazis, the enormous financial pressures put on Germany and punishment for Germany created, in a very real sense, part of the soil where, which allowed for the rise of the Nazi because of the issue of humiliation.
Yeah.
And that... that experience, in which had, you know, enormously awful consequences, seems to me relevant in looking at Iran and Russia right now. So that the blowback is not a financial blowback. The blowback may be one around humiliation and disgrace, which drives people toward extremes rather than toward behaving the way they should. And certainly the more the plug is, financial plug has been pulled on Putin, the more extreme he's gotten, the more he's funded the, you know, it's completely counterintuitive, but that's how people respond psychologically to anything that smacks of humiliation, anything that smacks of humiliation. And it's very much the same thing, seems to me, with Iran. And you know, you have to go push so far, you have to devastate the country, which is really ethically questionable, in order to have the kind of repercussions that would lead Iran to, you know, toe the line.
Great questions, and you know, really fundamental to the question of the use of power generally, and these tools in particular. I would add an example to your cautionary question, which is, you know, the Japanese ambassador to the U.S. Told U.S. counterparts that Pearl Harbor was necessary because Japan was being strangled economically and in terms of the oil embargo at the time. And so so I think there's a real sort of cornered badger dimension to this that goes to questions of national identity, economic well-being. The way I thought about it, you're absolutely right. You have to take that into consideration. But I also think there are different ways of thinking about what we're trying to achieve with financial pressure, right? So at the top end is a wholesale sort of collapse of economy, regime change, and it's a sort of far end. On the other sort of mild end is you're trying to do something to demonstrate you're doing something, but you know it's not really going to impact any sort of actions or behavior or calculus. And so in between that, I think you've got a whole set of different things that you're trying to achieve with financial pressure.
And I think part of the key is understanding what you're actually trying to achieve. And it could be a series of these things. So for example, you could have a set of sanctions and measures that are really trying to ensure that a regime doesn't have access to particular equipment or capital that allows them to do very specific things. And so in some ways, the strategy on Iran started that way, which was, can you constrain their capital in a way that actually affects their ability to develop the nuclear program? It's not a campaign to hurt the Bazaaris in Tehran. It's actually, can you stop them from having access to the capital that allows them to invest in the kinds of things that the Revolutionary Guard wants to invest in that are then important for their nuclear program? So you can have a more constrained set of goals like that, and then begin sort of that escalation, a bit of which I described in the Iranian context that goes along the constriction campaign. And I think you've got to have clear what you're trying to achieve. The challenge now is, I think, again, we've gotten sloppy a bit with the way we've thought about and talked about these issues. And so there's sort of this maximalist sense of, well, we're gonna impose economic pain, and you know, without a great sense of kind of how that plays out, in order to change behavior or to deter behavior. That may or may not be feasible. You know, that may not even be a potential strategic goal. And there's also a sense that you can do it just with these tools, right? In some ways, these measures are like
psychologically wise.
Right, well, that's right, too. Or you know, just the question of whether or not it's even going to be effective. And then to your first question, and it relates, is, you know, the more brutal regimes or the autocratic regimes figure out how to use these kinds of constraints often to their benefit. So if you looked at Saddam Hussein, and I looked at this regime very closely, and we tried to find where he'd hidden assets and where his sons had hidden assets and all these kinds of things, the reality was that they used the oil food program, which was intended to allow them to use the sale of oil to feed the people. They basically used that as a loophole to control the contracts and to decide winners and losers and to siphon business to all the people and places that they wanted, to use it as a diplomatic tool and also to self-enrich. Frankly, not much different than what the Gaddafi regime did in terms of using financial isolation and then the opening to their personal advantage, you know, the population be damned. That was really their attitude. And when I was in Tripoli, by the way, a couple of years ago, just fascinated as to the lack of infrastructure development. I anticipated there would be at least some part of Tripoli that was developed, like kind of like Beirut, where there are real shining pockets of development. Not at all. I mean, just a population and a society bereft of any care or tending or investment. And it was just brutal, really bad. In any event, these regimes figure out how to profit themselves and the people really suffer. And in that regard, you know, the whole trend in the 90s and then even post 9/11 toward more targeted sanctions was an effort to try to deal with that impact, to say, look, those classic trade sanctions are really not achieving the goals that we want, and they're hurting the wrong people. So can we focus on regime leadership assets? Can we focus on particular industries or particular ways that will then change behavior? That's an imperfect science. And one of the challenges of what I've described is it can be very surgical in its application, but in its maximalist form, it starts to look like an all-out embargo. And that's, I think, what Iran has started to feel, which is their isolation in the banking world, the insurance world, the commercial world, the oil sector. They're now cut off from the world. So you have, in some ways, hermetically sealed, even better than in the past, the Iranian economy and exacerbated the inefficiencies and ill attributes of that economy internally. And so I think that there's a real interesting moral question about whether or not even these tools, when applied in a maximalist way, are achieving your results that you want by not affecting the common man on the street. Final point I would make is there's sort of this odd assumption in this field that at some point this kind of economic pressure will build an internal groundswell in opposition to the regime, either causing a change of behavior or a change of a regime itself. You've seen that in the Russian debate around whether or not the pressure on the oligarchs around Putin will actually pressure Putin to change his point of view. In my opinion, there's no evidence to suggest that that's a correct assumption. In the Russian context, or even in the context of other autocratic or even totalitarian states.
Is there any example where that's worked? It's talked about all the time. I can't think of an historical example where that's a good thing.
Yeah, I think if Iran works, it could be that Iran does that, because I think one way of looking at the data, I haven't seen polling on this, but one way of looking at the situation there is that the clerical regime is so worried about what appeared in the Green Movement, as well as the economic dissatisfaction, which was bubbling up in all sorts of ways, which, by the way, we don't see often reported in the Western media. Bizarre strikes and all sorts of things, undercurrents that they're worried about, that in of itself changed the notion of the path that the regime needed to take in order to survive. Whether or not economic power and the way we've talked about it has actually changed internally a regime, I can't think of an example, to be honest, which is important to keep in mind. So I agree with you. I think we always have to sort of test our assumptions in this space. And one of the things I argue in the book is we certainly should not be thinking of this as a singular power to be leveraged in the hard cases by itself. There have to be other attributes of leverage, diplomacy, even kinetic power that shapes an environment to try to achieve a different result. If we're simply relying on these tools, you may not get the kind of change behavior that you want, and that may be what we're seeing in the Russian context. Yes, sir? I'm not sure it'd be a test of that, in part because if we end up lifting the sanctions, I think it will ultimately test the proposition, which is yet another assumption which I haven't seen proven out, that extreme economic interaction will actually drive fundamental political change or even regime change. One could argue we've changed fundamentally the nature of the Chinese regime because of sort of the commercial and economic nature of the relationship, but it's still a communist regime with all sorts of controls. For those of you who've been to China, you know that there are all sorts of media controls, and it's still a communist regime. And so that assumption is not proven out either. And in the Cuban context, I would argue, and I think there's a healthy debate as to whether or not which way we should go with the policy. But there's one way of arguing that, look, the Cuban economy and people have already been buffeted by Western investment and tourism. It just hasn't been from the U.S. It's been from around the world. And they've also seen and experienced what life in the United States is like, because a lot of the Cubans come to the U.S. and go back. A lot of family members send care packages and travel back and forth. My mother's Cuban, so I know this. I've got family come back and forth. So the notion of a demonstration effect, which is often kind of talked about as, you know, well, they'll see what kind of lifestyle they can have. I'm not sure that there's much evidence that that has driven grand political change either. Maybe you could say in the Eastern Bloc, perhaps, that was an impact, but I think there were other factors at play there. So Cuba's a really interesting case study to see play out. And by the way, the Cuban trade embargo was of the old school of trade sanctions, that's the way I like to describe it. We looked at how we could maybe use some of these tools in the Cuban context, but there was just not the right moment or opening, and frankly, the environment didn't play to the strengths of these tools, whereas the North Koreans did, right? The North Koreans played right into our hand in many ways by the way that they were operating. Yes, sir.
I wanted to ask you a question that's been coming up in the media a lot in the last month.
Yeah.
Regarding 9/11 and the question of where do the Saudis actually lie in terms of an ally or a foe. Mm-hmm. Now, the big issue in this argument is the issue of the 28-page chapter of the 9/11 report, which Bush classified, Obama has maintained a classification, in which the people working on the report and those congressmen who have read it now said pose no national security risk to declassify it. I know that you have stated that there's no evidence that the funding from the Saudi embassy to two of the hijackers had any role in assisting their capability to pull off 9/11.
Who said that?
I believe you said that.
Oh, I said that. Okay, good. According me to me, that's great. I like that. Thank you.
I believe so. That's what I, yes.
That's pretty good.
So my question is, you know.
Oh, did I hear this, Brandon? Oh,
my question is, Senator Graham, at a press conference January 7th, stated the question is, that still remains, the U.S. policy is formally, these 19 hijackers acted alone. The question remains, did they have assistance? And he argues, and many other argue, the release of the 28-page chapter of the 9/11 report is key to answering that question. So my question is whether you support releasing the 28-page chapter, declassifying it.
I'm not going to talk about classified stuff because I can't. I still carry clearances and such. But I will say this. I wrote an entire chapter in my book about the Saudi question. And so I commend it to you. It's chapter 3. Two things to note. One is there's no question that historically the Saudis and Gulf states had provided financial support to the growth of the global jihadi movement, born out of the Afghan Mujahideen and Arab movement to fight the Soviets. Right, there was an entire infrastructure built around that, supported by the Pakistanis, even by the U.S. to a certain extent. By the way, the idea though that the U.S. supported bin Laden is a fallacy, right? It's often, and even among experts, often kind of thrown in a very sloppy way into the idea that the U.S. was supporting the Mujahideen, right? There was no direct support to bin Laden. There was a lot of suspicion around him. Frankly, he was kind of a marginal player in the context of the other actors there. So just for those who are wondering, I think that's an important point of clarification. But in terms of Saudi support, there's no question that there was funding that had been coming out of the Saudi coffers to elements of this network around the world, whether it was to the Wahhabi proselytization, as we were talking about earlier, served as sort of an ideological set of outposts for al-Qaeda. And we had hard and long discussions with the Saudis about that. What's the role of IRO? What's the role of WAMI? What's the role of al-Haramain? And we worked with them often in difficult diplomatic ways to shut some of those things down. And we did it through the UN and otherwise. So there's no question about that. And certainly there were, prior to 9/11, suspicious relationships and problematic ones. The question in my mind is post 9/11 what happened. Because post 9/11 what you had was a complete reframing of the environment. To say, look, whatever was happening in the past cannot happen anymore. We cannot have this kind of a network existing. We can't have this kind of funding. And certainly al-Qaeda cannot and should not receive any support from anywhere in the world, in particular from our allies. You know, keep in mind the UAE had once recognized the Taliban government. UAE is one of our most important allies in the region, fighting alongside us in Afghanistan and around the world. So there's a real difference between pre-9/11 and post-9/11. I think that's an important note. There's also an important distinction between what individuals do in a country and what the country itself is sponsoring officially. That line blurs, especially in monarchies, as you know. But I think there's an important distinction there. And that's an important one to keep in mind, including when you look at questions, for example, of what happens in Pakistan, for example, in their relationships, for example, with the Haqqani network or with Lashkar-e-Taiba and other groups. And so having clarity in the public discourse around where that sits is important. The third point I'll make, not as a point of diversion, but as an important academic point and point of interest, is there's a lot of interesting questions around the Saudi dimension of the 9/11 report. There's also a part of the 9/11 report that talks about Iranian involvement with al-Qaeda. That if you look back at the report,
not part of a classified annex or anything, but you look back at the report, the conclusion is that there were interesting and important links that needed to be investigated. And if you look at revelations by the U.S. government in recent years about al-Qaeda support networks operating in Iran, to include funding, there is an interesting question as well as to whether or not there have been marriages of convenience or moments of marriages of convenience between the Iranian regime and al-Qaeda. And I would say if one were to say, look, there's unfinished business about understanding Saudi support to al-Qaeda, I'd say that's fair. But I'd also say there's unfinished business and homework around the Iranian relationship.
And I'd also say there's unfinished business about the United Kingdom and their relationship to the Saudis. Because if you talk about the Saudis, you can't not talk about Great Britain. With the Ali Imama deal of the 1980s,
yeah.
Between Bandar.
I think the issue with...
And Lundanistan.
Yeah. No, that's absolutely right. You've had that issue not just in the UK, but in France and elsewhere, where the question of did we pre-9/11, again, this is sort of this change of reference on 9/11 because of how dramatic it was and a change of the risk calculus. Did the West, in the context of allowing Lundanistan to operate, Abu Hamza al-Masri to preach and to fund and to allow the shoe bomber and all these other terrorist operatives to actually train and to operate openly in London, whether or not we were really wise to the threat that was among us.
But why do you think the administrations are so against declassifying it?
I can't comment on that because it starts to blend into what I may or may not know from a classified perspective. I think the Obama administration should consider it because I think having an open dialogue about what we knew or didn't know is important. I would also say, look, we've got to look at the difference between pre-9/11 and post-9/11. There's a real distinction. And I think, one of the key things that the president did on 9/11 was to say, look, we're in a different environment. And the conversations with the Saudis, the Pakistanis, and all our allies around the world was about the need to change the frame of reference. And that was really an important part of that period. One more.
This topic of what tips the scales from financial diplomacy to financial warfare seems to be fascinating. You alluded to the Russian example of sort of that self-declaring what they would consider an act of war. So can you help us understand and give some examples maybe in your mind? Because that would be a subjective call. That's the person who's the target saying this now amounts to war. Can you think of indicia or attributes of the different things as they type? What moves it from diplomacy more to warfare in some objective way?
That's a really good question. I'm going to answer it a couple ways because I also want to reflect on the convergence and the difficulties and tension with diplomacy in this space. In terms of how you define where it crosses the line, there is no... This is why I'm saying, look, there's no defined doctrine or set of norms around this, which is what makes it so interesting, I think. And so there's no kind of clear definition. I think you could argue, or one could argue, if your country, and you have a major financial institution or a major sector of your economy that is somehow taken down or affected or forced to sort of shut down, that's really central to your economy. And it could be just your identity. Maybe it's not a percentage of GDP, but it's actually part of your identity. That in and of itself could be considered an act of war sort of broadly. And then that could take different forms. It could be a cyber takedown, right? Sort of the systems of a major American bank taken down. Maybe we consider that to be an act of war. All of our bank accounts are erased. That would be problematic. And maybe even... cataclysmic in some ways. For those of you in the audience who have lots of money in bank account, maybe it's a real problem. But you could see sort of financial constriction in a more aggressive way. So this unplugging of all the banks, the Russian banks from SWIFT, maybe that does look like war to the Russians. And maybe it should, right, from their perspective.
maybe something short of that, but that really is long-term detrimental to a country, and you kind of hit a nerve, that can be considered an act of war. But the easy shorthand answer is there is no definition. And I think part of that is the subjectivity of the space and of the diplomacy that goes into it. On the other point I wanted to make is there is, what's interesting about this space, unlike the diplomatic and trade sanctions of old that were often really tied to diplomatic steps and measures, for which there's merit, right, in that approach. And you've seen the Russian sanctions program really take that, a bit of that strategy and a bit of this other strategy and combine them. That is to say, we're going to increase pressure only when Putin does something wrong or there's a, that he's not taking a diplomatic off-ramp, then we're going to up the pressure. But we're really going to take this in sort of diplomatic steps as opposed to conduct-based financial isolation around other issues. But the problem with the approach I described here is the problem that we had in the North Korea context. And again, it's sort of the heart of the book. There's three chapters on this whole episode. There's a whole chapter on the attempt to unwind the sanctions. And that's playing out in the Iranian context. Because a core question here is, okay, let's say we've identified all these illicit activities, we've decided to unplug these banks from the system, we've said they're bad actors, suspect actors, but you get a nuclear deal. Now what? They're still doing these bad activities, they're still a threat to the financial system, the elements and the principles of that financial isolation are still at play. How do you unwind them? How do you plug them back into the system? How do you justify that? It may make a ton of sense diplomatically as part of a deal. It may make absolutely no sense from a financial isolation perspective. So at a certain point, you can have a divergence, regardless of how you construct these, you can have a divergence of interests and purposes between the elements of this modern financial isolation, which is conduct-based, and the need to use those pressures as a diplomatic tool and implement. And I think that's a really interesting and difficult question, and one that we're struggling with in the Iranian context. Because the Iranian sanctions aren't all about the nuclear program. It's about Iranian terrorist financing. It's around Iranian proliferation financing. It's around money laundering. It's around sanctions evasion. A whole set of systemic questions that has driven the isolation. What happens if there's a nuclear deal? How do you unwind it? Question formation.
Well, let's thank Juan, and please, buy the book.